Alright, how you doing, guys? We're back. Gonna be doing a video here. It's gonna be a collection video. Now, I've done a movie collection video before. Maybe a couple of them, actually, for this channel. This is sort of sprung from a conversation I had the other night with my friend Nick, Maxwell Stars Beer Reviews. We were chatting on my live chat. Of course, he's always on the BDU live chat as well that we do with the Albino Rhino. And we got started talking about music collections, and he said he wanted to actually see what my CD collection at the very least was like. So I decided, hey, why not? Something to put up on the channel. I don't do as many reviews and shit now, so trying to fill up the channel with at least a couple videos a week. So here's something for you guys, and for Nick specifically. And also Ewart as well, because I kind of dared Ewart, if I put up my collection, you have to put up your collection as well. So we'll see if he actually does it. He might not. I don't care. I'm not going to hold him to it. But anyway, I will say this is indeed just my CD collection, not my entire music collection, because I have a lot of tapes as well still that still work, by the way, and a lot of digital albums. And a lot of illegal downloads as well. When it comes to stuff that I just can't readily get for a decent price, or just can't buy anymore because it's so fucking obscure, fuck yeah, I'm going to steal it from the internet. I'm going to find a blog that caters to that sort of thing, and even if it's a rip from a vinyl to MP3, I'm going to fucking do it if I want that music. And I can't get it any other way. And also, in some cases, some stuff's just, like I said, too expensive. Like, some of these albums are out of print, and then you go on eBay or one of those places and paying exorbitant prices for those. Even new albums as well. Even though, you know, CD prices have really gone down in the last 5-10 years, even more, really. They still get you with the fucking, get you with all the fucking shipping charges. I mean, shipping to Canada, or shipping things into Canada, I should say, incredibly fucking expensive. And, I mean, there's some cases where an album is only, like, you know, $10. That's about kind of the high-end price for a lot of albums these days, CDs at least. And, you know, there's some cases where the shipping ends up being, like, double or triple that. Like, I'm not doing that. Fuck that shit. So this is going to be a long video, but I'm going to get through this stuff. Some of these artists here, of course, I don't have their entire album collections on CD, but a lot of them I do have a vast amount of their stuff. I think people who know me know I'm a big Neil Young fan. I'm not going to show you any of my Neil Young stuff because that's a collection I share with my dad, and I didn't have time to go looking for it to bring it and show that to you as well. Like, we share a ton of vinyl, a ton of fucking tapes, and a ton of fucking CDs. We have almost every Neil Young album on CD, but yeah, I couldn't get to it in time for this video to show those to you as well. It would have made this video probably twice the length because, man, Neil Young has a lot of albums. But and also, we also share a bunch of other stuff on CD and vinyl as well. So maybe someday I'll do a thing showing you all the old weird vinyl that my dad's collected and that we've sort of gotten together over the years in yard sales and shit like that. But until then, just strictly my CD collection. And of course, I'm also not going to show you, like, burnt off CD albums and stuff like that, because that would go way into the future before this fucking video ever ended. So we're just going to strictly go with official CD releases right now. And we'll start here. Alright, all my albums from The Stooges and Iggy Pop. And of course, like I said, I own a lot more in various other formats, but I do have the original Stooges album. I'll put these on the floor as I go. I have Funhouse, their second album. And Raw Power. So there you go. And this is the studio corrected version of Raw Power. It's not the David Bowie mix, which kind of killed the guitar sound in that. Even though it was still thundering, pounding fucking guitar, it kind of killed the sound. And then I have a more recent Stooges album, like when they reformed. And it's alright. Not that great. And the one Iggy Pop album I actually do have on CD, official release anyway, Skull Ring, which was sort of like Grandpa playing with a couple other people. Like there's a Sum 41 collaboration on this, and I think one or two collaborations with Peaches as well. And it's actually not a bad album. And I mean, Iggy Pop really doesn't. He's hard to clamp down as having a certain sound, too, because he's really gone way out in different directions over the years, especially with some of his latest albums as well. So, it wasn't too bad. Here we go. My favorite band as a teenager growing up, Nirvana. So we have Nevermind, Incesticide. We have In Utero, which is my favorite of theirs. And we have The Unplugged, and the From the Muddy Banks of the Wiska, which is all the sort of different live performances. And I also have, I forgot to dig it out, but I do have the When the Lights Out, With the Lights Out sort of box set kind of thingy. Big fold out fucking thing with all the rarity and shit on it, which is pretty cool as well. And I do have Bleach on cassette, so I do pretty much own all their official releases anyway, except for like their Greatest Hits album that came out there that time. The Doors. Original Doors album. And then Strange Days. Waiting for the Sun. Soft Parade. Morrison Hotel. And L.A. Woman. There you go. Let's go. Classic metal now. Black Sabbath. And then Paranoid. Master of Reality, of course. Volume 4. And Sabbath, Bloody Sabbath. And I should really get Sabotage and, what's the other one? Is it called Symptom of the Universe? I'm getting it a little confused, but they had a couple more with the original lineup. And they had some good ones too, when, you know, after Ozzy left as well, but, not quite as into Black Sabbath after Ozzy left, so. There we go. The band, on any given day, it's either this band or another band I tell you is my favorite band of all time. The Ramones. And I know I have their first couple albums as well, but don't have them on CD right now. But here we go. Road to Ruin. End of the Century. The beautiful mess that they did with Phil Spector. And there we go. Pleasant Dreams, and Subterranean Jungle, Too Tough to Die. Those were all re-releases. They got like the fold-out sleeves and everything like that, and they have like a bunch of rarities on them as well. And then of course I got the two Ramones. Well, technically I guess I do have the early Ramones albums on CD, because All the Stuff and More, Volume 1 and 2, basically do the classic albums that everyone raves about, and then after that everyone sort of says, oh, the rest of their stuff sucked, which isn't true. And I got their record here, the Greatest Hits Live, with it's got the Motorhead Ramones on it, I believe. If I remember correctly, it's got two studio tracks, Any Way You Want It, a cover of that from the Dave Clark 5, Dave Clark. Did I say that right? Yeah, I think it's Dave Clark 5. And the Ramones. I can't remember. I keep getting that mixed up with the guy who did the New Year's Eve shit and did the American Bandstand. Have the Ramones, Hey Ho, Let's Go, which is essentially all the stuff and more again, with some different stuff on it as well. It's kind of a greatest hits kind of thing. And I got Joey Ramone's solo album that he put out before or just after he died. I can't remember if he was still around to see it released or not. Excuse me. Alright. We have Nick Cave and the Bad Seeds. So there we go. We've got Tender Prey there. And we have Let Love In. And we have the Murder Ballads, which is pretty interesting. And then we have probably my favorite from them, the Abattoir Blues and Lyre of Orpheus double album. But also really like this one as well, Dig Lazarus Dig. And I got a couple more of their stuff on digital formats as well. And, of course, their side project, Grinder Man, which is fucking awesome. And I have the second album as well. But that is a digital one. Here we go, another favorite of mine, John Spencer Blues Explosion. So, here we go. Orange. My favorite from them, Now I Got Worry, which is just a fucking kick-ass album. Track to track, from start to end. And then we have this one here, their Plastic Fang, which is fun. And then the sort of side project for John Spencer, Heavy Trash. I have their first album, then Going Way Out with Heavy Trash, and Midnight Soul Serenade. There we go. All good stuff. And let's get into another one here. Alright, we're at 12 minutes. We're not doing too bad. Not as bad as I thought we were going to do. Another all-time favorite of mine, Tom Waits. Not a big fan of his like earlier, like really super jazzy stuff. But once he started going weird, I really started getting into him. I'm really into that stuff. But here we go, Rain Dogs. This is, of course, an album everyone should own. Bone Machine, which was his big MTV kind of hit kind of thing, like, hey, kids can think this old crazy guy's cool, kind of stuff. But Blood Money, Real Gone, which is fucking kick ass. That one, it's just raw and fucking loud and nasty. And Orphans, which is a big collection of sort of rarities and B-sides and stuff like that, which is pretty goddamn fucking cool. There's a lot of great shit on all three discs of this. And the Glitter and Doom Live, which is, of course, from his live tour, which is pretty goddamn it. Tom Tales on the second disc, which I haven't listened to yet, actually. I can't believe I haven't done that. I'm gonna have to get on that at some point. But, yeah. Of course, again, that's not all I own from Tom Waits, but it's what I have on CD. Yeah, here we go. The other band, if you ask me at any given time who my favorite is, this is the other one I could pick. The Rolling Stones. I have Aftermath. Out of Our Heads, The Rolling Stones. December's Children. And then when they started really getting good, Let It Bleed, and Sticky Fingers, with the obscene boner in the on the cover. Of course, you don't have the zipper cover, which is the most famous one, the Andy Warhol designed, I believe. Exile on Main Street, which actually I think is kind of fucking overrated. This is like some sort of Canadian re-release of the fucking thing, I guess. But a bit of an overrated album. Sound production on it's a little shitty, I personally think. But I guess you know, the mythology of the Rolling Stones, a lot of their debauchery and all that sort of centers around that album in a certain way. So that's why that one's sort of elevated to great status. And then this is one I bought early on, their 40 Licks, which is decent, but it cleans up their songs a little too much, I think. I think the production kind of, cleaning up the production kind of hurts it a little bit, but that's just me. But there's some good stuff on there. All right. Still more to go. I got some Beatles albums with the Beatles, which is probably my favorite one. It's got some pretty goddamn good stuff on there. This is where they were really starting to get out of just doing a lot of covers all the time. So there's some pretty good stuff on there. Beatles for Sale, which is pretty goddamn good as well. Sort of similar to with the Beatles in that they were getting more, branching out, getting more artistic, doing their own stuff. And I got Rubber Soul. I will never own fucking Sgt. Pepper. I don't like that album at all. Alright. Here's a less well-known band that some circles I run in, people will know who they are, but Deadbolt. And they do sort of a horror-influenced surf rock kind of thing. Very non-PC. They like playing up their characters of being these motorcycling tough guys who do voodoo and shit like that. But they're funny and they're actually pretty kick-ass. But here's Shrunken Head, and then Tiki Man. Their best title for an album, and one of the best titles for an album I've ever heard. Tijuana Hit Squad, there you go. Zulu Death Mask, and Voodoo Trucker, and I own a couple of their other albums as well, in other formats. Okay, next. Alright, the White Stripes. So here we go, just the White Stripes right there. And D. Stigil, I'm probably pronouncing that incorrectly. And those are pretty interesting. They're, you know, the early, much more raw, much more blues-influenced kind of stuff in some of these tracks. And then, of course, they had their big hit here, White Blood Cells. And it's still a classic album as far as I'm concerned. And this is where I stopped with them, actually, Elephant. After that, I didn't start really getting into their stuff after that so much with their other albums. So I kind of dropped it after that. Didn't buy any more of their stuff. Here's another band where I thought they had a couple of good albums, and then I stopped listening to them. As far as albums go, I still have like a couple of their singles from their later work. But here we go. And here we have the Strokes. This Is It, which I still think is a pretty good album. I mean, as far as a rip-off of early 80s band Television goes, or late 70s, early 80s. Anyway, a rip-off of, like, Television and all that other sort of jangly, rhythm-based kind of semi-punk, semi-new wave kind of thing. And Room on Fire, which is also pretty decent. Where they start... Where they start ripping off, like, fuck. Totally blanking here. Best Friend's Girl. You know the song, you know the band. It'll Come to Me Later and I'll Feel Like an Idiot. But they have a couple songs that sort of rip that off, and Kraftwerk to a small degree. But, and that album wasn't all that great, but it was alright. Again, another band with, couple albums, and after that I sort of lost interest because their sound sort of changed so drastically and just kind of got worse in my opinion. But we have the Hives with Vinny Vidi Vicious, I should say. And this is a kick-ass album. It's not their first one, but this is like pretty much a perfect album. Really, really good. And then they have Tyrannosaurus Hives. It still had a, overall still had a really great first side and a couple of alright stuff on the second side. People are like, young kids are looking at me like, no, like, confused. Side? What are you talking about? There's no sides on a fucking CD. But yeah, this is the old in me speaking. When I could still remember albums actually having fucking sides, you know? And I still sort of view them that way, even today. And here's where I stopped with them. The Black and White album, which is pretty much garbage. Honestly, it's just very uninteresting, I think. They're really going for like more of a Kraftwerk kind of thing when they're doing this one. But I'm not too into the Hives anymore, other than these albums. Let's see. Here we go. Mike Ness from Social Distortion, his two solo albums, Cheating at Solitaire and Under the Influences, where he's doing all kinds of country rock tribute kind of things, like rocking up old country songs and just sort of going through the stuff that sort of sparked his interest in music, the sort of rebel outlaw country music and things like that that he listened to. Pretty goddamn decent stuff. And Social Distortion Live at the Roxy. I should really own more Social Distortion albums, but I don't at this point. I have to rectify that at some point, but this is a good live album. Even if Mike Ness sounds kind of corny when he talks to the audience. Remember back when we were punk rockers and all this shit? I'm like, yeah, okay, dude. I guess he's talking to, like, 19-year-olds, so I don't know. Couple albums from Rancid. I got a couple more of their stuff on cassette tape, but I have Rancid's first album here. I can't remember if it's exactly their first album, but Let's Go. It's one of their earlier ones, anyway. And I have one of their... I stopped listening to them for a little while, and then they came out with this, which is just their sort of self-titled Rancid. I think 2000 this came out or something. Yeah, 2000. And it was pretty kick-ass. It was like Rancid does 80s hardcore kind of thing. It's a lot less of the ska influence and all that stuff. A couple from Queens of the Stone Age, Songs for the Deaf, and The Restricted album, which are both pretty goddamn good. Some of the more modern rock that I'm actually into is, you probably notice I'm not into that much modern stuff anymore. A lot of it doesn't really interest me all that much, but and here we have the double best of from Motorhead. I gotta get off my ass and get their other classic albums on CD. I have some of them saved on discs and stuff like that, but I don't have the official releases bought up. But as far as best of albums go, this one's pretty good. It's not bad. It's probably not quite as good as one of their greatest hits that they put out, I think, in the early to mid 90s or something along those lines, or maybe it was even late 80s. They've put out a few greatest hits albums, but this one has a couple unnecessary live tracks on it that really don't do anything for me, but pretty good. Alright, here's two albums from Horror Director, so a little crossover to my usual content on this channel. John Carpenter, his Lost Themes, and Lost Themes 2. I immensely enjoy these. These are just good sort of chill out electronic kind of stuff to listen to fall asleep to. Uses white noise. Not to say that they're bad songs or badly composed or anything like that, because they're not. There's actually a lot of good stuff on both those albums. But I do find it very relaxing and good way to sort of cut out any sort of unnecessary sounds when I'm trying to sleep as well. So I do enjoy those quite a bit. And the final band that I have multiple albums from to show you, The Misfits. So we have their Walk Among Us, which is probably their best classic album as far as I'm concerned. And it's got, you know, some of the original mixes and stuff for these songs. So it's not some of the later stuff that Danzig fucking fucked with and made sound like shit. From the new Misfits, I have their Project 1950, which isn't too bad. I mean, Jerry Only is no fucking Glenn Danzig as far as vocals go. And, you know, it's not really the Misfits, honestly. I mean, it just really isn't. But hey, they're using the name and they're profiting off the fucking merchandise and stuff like that, so whatever. But it's got Mark Ramone on fucking drums when he was still touring with them. And then they do some oldies, and some of them aren't too bad. It actually isn't a bad album. And of course, I have the two albums that I think just about everyone who was a Misfits fan for a while and just couldn't get any of the sort of the classic albums, because they sort of went into print for a while. The collection albums, Collection 1 and Collection 2. And there's a whole sordid history behind these two and why Collection 2 was released and all that stuff as well. It's all the legal mumbo jumbo and bullshit between Only and the other band members and Danzig. But these aren't bad. These were, you know, these were stuff I grew up listening to. In my case, living in buttfuck nowhere Canada, this was kind of the best I could hope for to get from the Misfits until really the internet really became something and stuff started getting distributed much better into more places. But a lot of the mixes actually on these are not what I prefer. I prefer the original mixes, and there's a lot of tinkering on some of that shit. So mostly my Danzig, by the way. And I got two actual Danzig albums. His solo, well, not solo, but, you know, him as a artist away from the Misfits. So Danzig, Danzig 2, and I own some more of that stuff as well. Although a lot of his later albums are kind of garbage, but whatever. Can't win them all. Can't knock them all out of the park. And now I'll just go over some of the individual stuff I own here. And of course I do, again, own some other stuff from some of these artists, but these are just, you know, the single one-off CDs that I have. Groovy Ghoulies, sort of a horror-influenced sort of power punk band to a certain degree, I guess. Pretty fun. Kind of jokey. Great, great band here, Dr. Feelgood, down by the jetty. Great British band, came into the sort of pub rock scene in Great Britain, and they're fucking awesome. At least they were when they had Wilco with them. Once he left, they kind of started getting a little too bluesy to a degree that I didn't like, and they started going downhill a little bit. But they still have some good stuff in their later albums as well. Classic album, Nevermind the Bollocks. Here are the Sex Pistols. Don't have to really say anything about that album, do I? Best of Jimi Hendrix. I think there's been about a million best of Jimi Hendrix things. This is one of those cheap ones you can buy, you know. Got some good stuff on it. Best of Johnny Cash. I'm not a big Johnny Cash fan, but there's definitely some stuff of his I like. And there's some alright stuff on here. I mean, at least you got Ring of Fire, Boy Named Sue, Sunday Morning Coming Down, although I prefer the Kris Kristofferson, his version. Folsom Prison Blues, I Walk the Line, and then it gets into some dodgy stuff. doesn't really pick up again until Get Rhythm, but there you go. Chuck Berry Gold, which is basically just a reprint of his singles stuff. I mean, that's pretty much what you get with all these sort of classic artists anyway. I mean, they didn't necessarily have proper albums. The idea of them having proper albums wasn't a thing until, like, the 70s, and even then a lot of them probably didn't do it. If they did release, like, a album, it was just a collection of singles, for the most part. It wasn't, you know, a piece of artwork with a concept behind it or anything like that. But there you go, Chuck Berry Gold. You got, what, 30 songs on there. Two discs, 30 songs. Some of it's not all that great, of course, but it's got all the hits on there anyway, all the classic stuff. Then we have a couple from the 20th Century Masters series that came out a little while ago, back in, when was it? 2000-something, wasn't it? 1999. Okay, there you go. The John Lee Hooker Millennium Collection. It's not too bad. and then the Chuck Berry one as well, which is kind of obsolete now that I have Chuck Berry Gold. Should probably try to sell this at a yard sale or something for 3 cents. Then I have a couple, the Essential Blue Archive series, which is a really cheap archival series, but it's got some interesting stuff on these things, though. I got the John Lee Hooker and the Muddy Waters one. So, yeah, there's some good stuff on this, actually. Some things I never heard before from them. And some of their hits as well. So, it's not too bad. These were dirt cheap. So, you know, just pick them up just to have them. What else do we have? Oh. Getting mixed up here. And to wind down, I have Beck's Sea Change, which is his, I guess, his breakup album with his wife or whatever, his first wife or whatever. So it's all like depressing, fucking sad songs. But the time I did buy it, I was in a pretty depressed state, so it was kind of fun to have. Kind of helped. Frankenchrist from the Dead Kennedys. Not their best album, but it's probably one of their better known ones. Great band here, New York rock band, The Dictators, Go Girl Crazy, some great stuff on there, sort of proto-punk to a certain, they're not quite punk rock, but they're kind of proto-punk, sort of. The Ramones are more punk rock than they are, let's put it that way. So, Tenacious D, why not, I like the D. Don't take it that way. I mean, I like the Tenacious D, not the other D, you know. Then I have this really cheap box set that I bought. It was so dirt cheap, but it was like fucking 30 songs on it as well. John Lee Hooker, Most Famous Hits, the album. I don't even know who the fuck this... Who's this released by? This could have been even like a dodgy illegal release. Who knows? But it's got some good stuff on it. It's got most of his hits on it, so it's not too bad. Amérique du Sud, which is a collection of sort of revival of Inca music, like music from the Andes and stuff like that. I do like that stuff, like the actual band Los Incas, I really like. And so yeah, it's got some of their stuff on here. I was trying to find their like classic albums. Los Incas was actually a sort of French Canadian musicians, studio musicians, who just did a couple albums. They're best known for El Condor Pasa, which I think Paul Simon sort of co-opted and and put lyrics to it, which was fucking abysmal. But this is sort of the music that I think I'm episode of South Park makes fun of, you know, like just like Incan or Aztec or Andes pipe bands or whatever you want to call them that are, you know, panhandling for money or whatever. But this stuff is actually really good. It's not generic sounding. It's got a real sort of sense of folk music to it, a sense of culture. And I really like this stuff. I grew up listening to this stuff. My dad and I have an actual Los Incas albums on vinyl and some other collections of other bands that were doing this stuff, so I do really like that stuff. And two soundtrack albums, and we're done. We have the Popol Vuh soundtrack for Nosferatu from 1979, and this is great. It's got a couple extra things on here that were not on the original release, and of course very little of this was actually written for the movie. It was more of a he brought in some of his older stuff, a little bit of the older stuff from the Popol Vuh's other releases was sort of co-opted for this album in the first place. Some of it was, you know, re-recorded and stuff like that, but Most of their albums sort of were like longer set pieces of like big spanses of music. Like I think a couple of their albums only have like two tracks on them or whatever. So this is, you know, they cut parts out of those albums and stuck them in as songs here that, you know, even then some of these are like 5-6 minutes long. And then of course there is some original music on here that was written for the actual movie too. So I love it. It's a great soundtrack. Grew up listening to it. And for one of my favorite films, I think it was my favorite film of 2015, 2016, somewhere around there. Turbo Kid. My brain is totally fucking scrambled. It's very late, so, and I'm just sort of doing a spur of the moment anyway. So, yeah, Turbo Kid, Les Matos, I believe they're called, yeah, or Les Matos, French-Canadian band. They do sort of electronica music, but, you know, it's kind of that retro 80s throwback electronica kind of stuff. And my God, it's a double album. I mean, you got your actual original motion picture soundtrack, which has 39 tracks on it, and then you just have the Chronicles of the Wasteland, which is a sort of extra album with just 10 tracks on it, and then some of that stuff comes over to the soundtrack album, but in different forms. Really good stuff, great chill out kind of music as well. Very fun soundtrack. Kind of listen to that the same way I listen to the John Carpenter stuff, when I just want to drown out all the extra out there that's keeping me awake. But there you go, Nick. Anyone else who gave a fuck and lasted just 36 minutes or whatever, there's my physical CD collection as it stands. So, yeah. You can make fun of me in the comments, or you can say my collection looks really cool. I don't give a fuck. Either way, I think most of my friends know that my music tastes are fairly wide-ranging and eccentric at times. I mean, this doesn't even really cover my taste at all. I mean, there's just so much stuff I actually listen to and like. So, but I'm not one of those pretentious wankers that says I like everything as well, because I fucking hate that. Oh, I love a little everything. No, you fucking don't. If you do, I don't think you actually like music. You just have it as background noise. I like people who have some discerning tastes, actually. But anyway, 37 minutes in now. So it's about time I fucked off, and it's about time you fucked off. So let's all fuck off.